Well, good morning, everybody. It's good to see everybody. Glad to have Brother Chase and his family back with us this Sunday morning. And got just a few announcements. We got the Wednesday nights. Don't forget about Wednesday nights. It's mostly the same announcements. Wednesday nights will be 6 o'clock starting to eat, adults and children. We need a few more adults to come. KM is a real good teacher, and as you know from Sunday mornings, but from what I understand, I haven't had the ability or chance to come up and listen, but he makes it more like a Bible study. Everybody gets involved, and I really enjoy those. So come on and visit with us on Wednesday night and come up here with KM. Also, reach out to anybody you know with children. Please send them in. We have a good group, but we could always love to have more because we need to be teaching them now so they'll have something. It's KM, the honey and the rock that may, you know, that rock is God. And that's what we need to be teaching these children, that they have a rock to stand on and have us as brothers and sisters to lean on. So let's see, the food, the potatoes, the boxed potatoes, we did 44.6 pounds. That's good. And this month's item is canned corn. And then what else? We have a business meeting after church today. So after our closing song, if everybody would just please have a seat. I think Lauren's going to do children's church, so Patricia and I will get to stay up here. So we'll have that business meeting immediately after church. Anything else I'm forgetting?
Dollar
on the pew. Golly bum, I had that all set up there. So today's dollar on the pew. And as always, a dollar doesn't go very far. So if you can spare more, just give what the Lord can allow you to give. And, you know, let's give back some of the love that we felt and the blessings that God's bestowed on us. Let's spread that around.
And she's writing the check at the end of the month.
Okay, she's writing the check at the end of the month. So if you didn't bring a dollar today, you can bring a dollar next week or the week after. You have till the end of the month. How about that? To give, and just keep giving if you like. That'd be great. So this time,
anything you find on the pews, right?
Yeah, actually, anything that you find on the pews is God's.
You're going to collect for it, though.
I can if I need to. all right. Anything else?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, Patricia, you're full of it.
Well,
morning,
we,
aren't you?
You know, next every year we always do the shoes for the yes. Georgia Baptist Children's Home. I've not spoke with Amber yet, but we've already been asked by our sister church, will we be willing to help? So I think we've been doing it, but I think everybody needs to be kind of in agreement so I can let Diane know.
Yeah, think about that.
Yeah,
good. We'll enter that
in
the business meeting as well. And also, Fall Festival, I forgot about that.
Yes.
It's October 23rd.
Yes.
Sunday night, 5 o'clock till whenever it goes to dark or whatever. We're going to have it at Lazy Creek Farms. And also, we've asked our sister churches, Everett Springs and Mount Tabor, to come as well. And they seem very excited about it. And I know I'm excited about it because it's always fun to get all our churches together. It needs to be an outreach. So if you know anybody that's not churched, please invite them. They're invited.
We saw a
covered dish. I'm sorry. Yeah, covered dish. I'm not sure how that's handed out because we're waiting. They're actually announcing it to the church today, but I know it's already been passed around through text and emails. So we'll have more information this afternoon, and I'm hoping that we can have a lady from each church get together so we don't have 42 pots of green beans and 12 pots of corn, which I'd be okay with that, but we can't even eat it all. To spread it around, but it will be like a potluck. How about that? That sounds good. An organized potluck.
Stan's bringing his keyboard.
Yeah, Stan Peffel's going to bring his keyboard. He says we're going to make it a party. And so I hope that he and David can get together, and whoever's at Mount Tabor can get together and really. I don't know about them Methodist party. They're not Methodist party. <sorry. laughs> I grew up Methodist, so I can talk about it. But anyway. All right, anything else?
Be up for any jamming.
Who would be?
Wayne Hopper.
Went, oh, yes, he definitely would. That man, he's awesome. Yes, ma'am. That's right,
yes.
Thank you. I tell you what, I'm just terrible at this. Maybe I should let y'all come, please. I would love for y'all to come up here and do this. Fifth Sunday night singing, October, what, 30th, 31st, something like that? 30th at Everett Springs. And it's going to be a green hymnal singing. Another potluck that night. So we're going to have two Sundays in a row with potluck. That's great, man. I'm looking forward to that. All the good food, good eating. All right. Anybody else?
I asked, is the fire truck going to be running?
No, ma'am. I'm sorry. I have the stuff for the fire truck, but the fire truck's not running, so I'm sorry. And I had somebody else ask about that too, so maybe one day. The plate's very full. And I'm about ready to crack it. All right, I'm gonna turn it over to David now. Let's worship the Lord.
There you go. Thanks, bud.
Okay, you ready to sing now? Okay, let's stand and sing. This is the day. We'll go through it one time, and then we do Jesus' name above all names.
Trust in Jesus, just to trust His
521 on Jordan Stormy Banks, I Stand. Continue to pray for a revival in our hearts each and every day. It's what we need in this day and time. It's what we need in this church and in this community, in this state, this country. That's just what we need. And it starts in the individual heart. So I pray that you readied yourselves this morning for the preaching of God's word. And if you'll meet me in verse 41...
I had prepared different messages for this morning throughout the week, and like I've heard another preacher say, just prepared the wrong message. But last night, the Lord put this on my heart, and I truly believe it's what He would have us go over today. And so, if you would, just be praying throughout this service. I've never preached this message before. But I just pray that, I just hope that you'll pray for me throughout this service. So, let's look at verse number 41, Luke chapter 2, verse 41. The Bible says, "Now his parents went to Jerusalem every year at the feast of the Passover. And when he was 12 years old, they went up to Jerusalem after the custom of the feast." Verse 43, when they had fulfilled the days as they returned, the child Jesus tarried behind in Jerusalem, and Joseph and his mother knew not of it. But they, supposing him to have been in the company when a day's journey, and they sought him among their kinsfolk and acquaintance. Verse 45, and when they found him not, they turned back again to Jerusalem, seeking him. Verse 46, and it came to pass that after 3 days they found him in the temple, sitting in the midst of the doctors, and both hearing them and asking them questions. And all that heard him were astonished at his understanding and answers. And when they saw him, they were amazed. And his mother said unto him, "Son, why hast thou thus dealt with us? Behold, thy father and I have sought thee sorrowing." In verse 49, and he said unto them, "How is it that ye sought me? Wist ye not that I must be about my father's business?" Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for the singing this morning, Lord, and I thank you for the reading of your word, Lord. If we went home right now, Lord, it'd be sufficient enough. We've read your word, Father, Lord, but I ask you for the unction and the power of your Holy Spirit, Lord, to use me as a tool, Father, to set me aside, hide me behind your cross, Lord. And I pray, Lord, that you would prepare the hearts and minds, Lord, that the people in here would have ears to hear this morning. Lord, I pray that you'd bind up the forces of hell this morning, Lord, so that we may focus on your word with clarity, Father. Remove all the distractions in this place. Lord, I ask that you would just be with us, that we would glorify and lift up your name, Jesus. Lord, I thank you, and all that we do, we'll be careful to give you all the honor, praise, and glory. And it's in Jesus' name. Amen. So, we see that the narrative here is that Jesus was just a child at 12 years old, and him and his family were journeying down to Jerusalem. I'm thinking this is about a 70-mile journey. Now, some of us wouldn't even, if we had to walk to church, none of us would be here today. But they traveled 70 miles to the custom of the feast, and so they were going to the Passover. And every year they'd take a caravan of people, and they would journey up to the Passover. And the Passover is a feast. The Passover is a feast of the Jews. It was instituted to celebrate and to recall and to show respect and to remember the providential escape of the Hebrews in Egypt, when God, smiting the firstborn of the Egyptians, passed over the houses of the Israelites, which were marked with the blood of the Lamb. So the Passover was to recall that. It was to have respect for that and honor it and to remember it. We know that in the Old Testament was the foreshadow of Jesus Christ. All things that happened was a foreshadow of Jesus Christ. And Jesus came, that we see in Luke 22, he instituted the Lord's Supper. We see that it was the last supper, they gathered in the upper room for the Passover, but Jesus instituted the Lord's Supper. No longer do we celebrate or do we honor the Passover, but now we partake in the Lord's Supper with a body honoring and remembering the body and the blood of Jesus Christ on the cross at Calvary. So, if you can, just imagine the perspective that Jesus must have had at 12 years old at the Passover. Jesus was a smart young man, and surely when he's at the Passover, he's there, and it's very personal to him. It was very personal to him. You see, the people that were there, they were looking back on what God had done for them. They were looking back on what God had done, but Jesus, when he was there, surely he was looking at the cross. Surely he was looking at what must be done for them. When the crowd was there, they saw an innocent lamb. They saw an animal being sacrificed. That's what the crowd saw. But Jesus, surely he saw himself and the sacrifice that he needed, that he must do for us. So Jesus saw himself there. Surely that must have been a difficult perspective. I couldn't imagine what Jesus was going through in his mind when he was there. I want to look at a couple different thoughts today. On one hand, we have the thought of if you can separate Christians in two different categories, I believe we can in this way. One Christian, a group of Christians will show up to church looking for what God can do for them. And one group of Christians will show up expecting God to give them something. And the other group of Christians will show up to church wondering what they can give to God. Surely the crowd showed up wondering what God had in store for them that day. But Jesus showed up wondering what he could give of himself to God. If you're a born-again believer in here, then you have the Holy Spirit within you. We need to understand that the fullness of God dwells in Jesus Christ. Would you agree that everything that God is dwells within Jesus Christ? And if you're a born-again believer, then everything that Jesus is dwells within us. So there's nothing more that you need from God on this side of glory. He's done everything that he's needed to do for us and you and I. And there's nothing more of him that he can give you. You have the entire, but there's not just a little bit of the Holy Spirit. That's not how it works. You have the entire fullness of God within you. And we need to understand that this morning. That surely if you're here today, it's only because there's something that we can give to God of ourselves. I'm talking about there's things going on in our lives that we're carrying around that we must give to God. How can God have more of me today than he had before I came in here? Surely that's the goal today. I pray that we'll consider that. Another thought is that you had in two different categories. We have the crowd, and you'll see that we have the crowd and that we have Jesus. The crowd and then Jesus. So when we look in these scriptures, we see that the crowd has made this journey, and they were on their way to do some churchy things. My pastor made up that word, churchy, and I like it, so I'm going to use it. They were on their way to do churchy things. These activities and the Passover and stuff that they were involved in, they weren't really bad things. Maybe here this morning, because it's the churchy thing to do. Maybe here this morning because there's people to see, or you need to be seen by somebody. Surely they had people there that just wanted to see. Surely they had people there that was just showing up because somebody else was there. Surely they had people there because they were part of the ministry. They had religious obligation. This had been on the calendar all year. Now, like I said, I like all the churchy things. I think we should come here and do all the things that the church should do, but we got to understand that we can't just be doing things to do things. That everything that we do must be to honor and glorify Jesus Christ. I believe that the crowd had gotten to a point to where they were doing things just to do things. A lot of our churches have gotten that way today, and we got to be sure that we don't end up there. And all of the planning and in all of the meeting and all of the gathering and the fellowshipping and the laughing and the talking, and from the arrival until the departure, we see that they had taken their eyes off of Jesus somewhere along the way. At some point, we're going to see in the scriptures, they had just taken their eyes off of him. Let's look at verse 43. And they, when they had fulfilled the days, when all the busyness was over, a bunch of busybodies, when all the busyness was over, when they had fulfilled the days, as they returned, the child Jesus tarried behind in Jerusalem, and Joseph and his mother knew not of it. They had no idea that they had gotten away from Jesus. See, as born again believers, we would never, on purpose, get away from Jesus. Surely they didn't leave him behind on purpose that day. Now, if the devil was to come up to you and tell you that God isn't real, he knows better than that, because we're just going to say, yeah, he is. He's not going to, when the devil tries to come into your homes or tries to get into your mind and things like that, he's not going to come at you with a pitchfork trying to knock down the doors. He's got to come at you in a way that's more deceitful than that. He's got to find something that you believe in, and he's got to try to change that slowly, a little by little. And I believe that the devil, he wants to get into the churches, and it's not that he would have the people in the church stay home, but it's that he would have the people go to a church where Jesus Christ is not glorified, where the gospel of Jesus is not being preached. And so we got to understand that this day, when they had left Jesus behind, it's not that Jesus was lost, but it's that he stayed behind and they left without him. It's not that they did that on purpose. We see that they had no idea they had gotten away from Jesus. Even if you come to church, even if you read your Bible and you have a strong prayer life and all the things that the Bible tells us to do, even all those things, you're keeping up with all those things, and you're like, I'm doing pretty good. Well, if you take your eyes off of Jesus, this world has a way of getting in between you and him. And that's what had happened here this day, is they took their eyes off of Jesus, and the world slowly got in between them and Jesus, to the point where he was nowhere in sight. He was nowhere in sight. And if you was here when I preached on John 15, I talked about abiding in Christ. To actively remain in Christ. To actively keep your eyes on Jesus through all that you do. It's easy to get busy in today's day, and it's easy to fill your schedule up from the time you wake up to the time you go to bed. But we must keep our eyes on Jesus. I want to use this illustration. I think that a lot of us will be able to relate to it. But if you go on vacation to the beach, and you're in the ocean, and your hotel is, you're in the water, you're in the ocean, and you're looking and you're facing your hotel. Now, if you want to stay right there, at least two things need to happen. One of those things is you need to be treading water. You need to be actively staying with your hotel, because if you don't, the current has a way of drifting you. You will drift further and further away from where you need to be. And it doesn't take, if you've ever done this before, I do it just about every time I'm in the ocean. I'll look up and I'll be like, where's my hotel? You know, I've done drifted 500 yards the other way. And you don't realize it. You start seeing different people, I have to keep looking at my hotel to make sure that I'm staying where I need to be. The other thing that needs to happen is you have to keep your eyes on your hotel. See, the hotel, in this illustration, that's Jesus. We have to keep our eyes on Jesus, because even through the treading of the water and even through the fighting of the current, if we take our eyes off of Jesus, if we take our eyes off that hotel, we'll still drift away. We will still drift away. And so we must continue to abide in Christ. We must keep our eyes on Jesus. And we'll see in verse 44, but they, supposing him to have been in the company, went a day's journey. Now they assumed that Jesus was with them. Well, he was with us the last time we checked, so why even worry about it right now? You know, we'll wait till we need him to see where he's at, right? Well, they just had took their eyes off of him just for a second. I mean, he was just right here. I don't know where he's at, but he was just right here. How could he get that far? How could we get that far away from him in that short amount of time? Yesterday, me and my wife was at the outlet mall in Calhoun at the Vanity Fair, and I probably haven't bought new pants in 3 or 4 years, and so it was well overdue. It's in there looking at pants, and my wife was handling my son, Leland, and he's a handful, and so especially in the stores, he thinks he's got to look at all the clothes like we do, and so. But my wife went over here to grab this pair of pants off this hanger off and show me these pair of pants. She walked about 20 feet, grabbed these pair of pants, and turned around, and Leland was gone. And she said, "Where's Leland?" And at first I was like, "Well, I saw him right here, and I just saw you do that. So I'll just walk over here and peek." And I walked over and looked, and he was nowhere to be found. I was like, okay. So I walked down the aisle by the racks, and I was looking for Leland, and all of a sudden my heart sunk, because all these clothing racks were so high. Little bitty Leland can't see them. All the clothing racks were so high. And my heart had sunk. And it's kind of like us. If we take our eyes off Jesus, the world will get in the way and it'll hinder our vision. Though we're looking for him, though we're trying to do the right things, the world will get in our way and it'll hinder that vision. And so we began looking for Leland. And I was running around trying not to panic. And we spent probably about a good minute, felt like 15 minutes looking for Leland. I mean, there's other people in there. And I was like, all right, I'm about to go stand by the door, shut the door down. And you know, all you parents in here, you know what I'm talking about. And my heart was thinking, before I knew it, we were in this little bitty area of that Leland had to be somewhere right here, you know, in about 1 minute, I'm over and I'm like, okay, he's got to be somewhere on this half of the store. Vanity Fair is a really big store. I'm like, he's got to be somewhere on this half of the store. In just 1 minute, I took my eyes off him for 1 minute, and it went from just right here to, okay, now we need to search this entire area. That's what I see when I see these scriptures, and we'll get to a verse later when it talks about they was looking for him. But in verse 44, we also see that they went a whole day's journey without Jesus. I feel like I did that yesterday with Leland, though it was about 1 minute, a minute and a half. I felt like it was a whole day's journey. Luckily, Jamie had found him, and I don't know what he was doing. There's no telling. But, you know, how many days have you gone this week without Jesus? Think about that. How many days have you woke up in the morning with every intention of fellowship? I'm not talking about the sonship of the Father. I know that if you are saved, he'll never leave you nor forsake you. You have the Holy Spirit residing in you. I'm talking about the fellowship with Jesus. I'm talking about the relationship with Jesus. How many times this week have you woke up with every intention to have and build on that fellowship with Jesus through his Holy Spirit, but you wake up in the morning and or you go to bed at night and you say, I'm going to wake up in the morning and try to get at least 15 minutes of reading time in and get some prayer time in, and you wake up and you realize that something has happened in that short amount of time from the time you went to bed till the time you woke up. Something has happened to where you no longer can focus on that 15 minutes. There's something you have to take care of. And so you take care of that. And you say, well, Lord, I on my way to work or on my way to wherever I'm going, I'll get in prayer and I'll spend some time with you. And then you go and you get in the car and somebody calls you and it's important and you have to answer it. And you're talking with them and then you get to work and you realize that you haven't spent any time with Jesus, and you say, on my lunch break, I'm going to spend time with you, Lord. I'm going to read my Bible on lunch. And then your co-workers come in, and they say, hey, we're going to your favorite place today to eat. And you're not going to turn that down because you're a Baptist. So you're not going to turn down your favorite place to eat. And you say, well, sure, my stomach is starting to rumble. I'm getting a little hungry, so let's go get something to eat. Say, Lord, when I get home, I'm going to read my Bible for just at least 5 minutes, if anything, Lord. And then you get home and you realize that your kids have done something that you've got to go and fix. Leland thinks he's got to pour milk in the glass or from glass to glass to glass. And he spills it everywhere. And then I have to go and clean it up. And I get distracted from... This world has a way of distracting us, is my point. You say, Lord, before I go to bed, I'm going to give you 15 minutes, and I'm going to pray before I go to bed. And you've done spent this whole day, and you're wore out. And finally, you sit there late at night, and you open up your Bible, and you start to read the Word of God, only to fall asleep a couple minutes later. Before you know it, you went a whole day's journey without Jesus. And it's not that you meant to. You had every intention. You didn't have any intentions of doing that. But that's what happened, because the world has a way of getting in between you and the Lord. We must keep our eyes on Jesus. We must build on that relationship with Jesus. And here's the sad thing is that, you know, we learned that in the scriptures that we must love Jesus more than we love our spouse. We must love Jesus more than we love everything else in this world, in this life. We must love Jesus more. But the sad thing is that you will go out of your way to improve and to interact and have and build on a relationship with everybody else, but not Jesus. Now, I want everybody to think about this week, this last week that you have just spent, this last week, if you was to take the time that you spent in fellowship in that relationship with Jesus, and you was to trade it with the relationship you have or had with your spouse or with anybody in your life, but I'm talking about for the spouses. If you don't have a spouse, then you can imagine this. If you was to take that time that you spent with Jesus this week, and you was just to spend that much time with your spouse, next week they'd probably be gone. Here's the thing. If the only time you read the Bible or the only time you're really in prayer is just a couple times a week, it's not enough. It's not enough to only be in prayer when you come into the church, to only be in prayer or read the Bible when you come into the church. It's not enough. If you was to only talk to your spouse once or twice a week, that's not going to work out. It's not enough. We must love the Lord more than we love everything else. Can you trust Him? He'll take care of it. You're saying, yeah, but I got to build a relationship with my wife or my kids. If you love Him more than all else, He'll take care of it. I promise He will take care of you. But see, we believe that Jesus will take care of us, right? But do we trust that Jesus will take care of us? That's two different things, and they're real similar. But two different things, believing and trusting. So not only do we believe that He can take care of the things in our life, but we must trust him as well. I'm going to turn to 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 11. I want to read this scripture. It says, "For we hear that there are some which walk among you disorderly, working not at all, but are busy bodies." There's some people that were not there for the right reasons. They're just there to be busy. There's people in the churches today that they're not doing any work for the Lord in their own lives at home. They're not doing any work for the Lord in their own lives when they leave the church, but they're so busy doing everything else. And this verse talks about the person who's too busy to have anything to do with the Lord, that wants that Savior but doesn't want that Lord, that's too busy to put him into the schedule, that Jesus has just become a sideshow, that they've just gotten too busy. These people are just too busy. Sometimes in our lives, we're just too busy. From the time we wake up to the time we go to sleep, we try to fill everything, we try to fill our days with everything. Man, we'll keep adding on to it and adding on to it and adding on to it. And Jesus in our days and in our lives, it keeps getting smaller and smaller. His part of our days keep getting smaller and smaller. Lord, I'm doing this for you though, but we push him to the side. We got to realize that the main thing is that we don't get too busy for the Lord. Look at verse 45. In verse 45, "And when they found him not, they turned back again to Jerusalem, seeking him." Now that's probably the best thing they've done since we've read these scriptures. As they started seeking him, they should have done this on the way there. They should have looked for God on the way there and made sure that they were trying to go to where God is on the way there. They turned back, they backtracked because they saw that Jesus was nowhere in the crowd. And in verse 46, "And it came to pass that after 3 days they found him in the temple." I want you to realize that one day's journey without Jesus Christ has turned into 3 days. One day's journey has turned into 3 days. The longer you spend apart from Jesus, it's harder to get back to him. You know, it's harder to get the things out of the way that have come up in the way in our lives. It's harder to get back to the Lord. But sometimes there's relationships that have entered our lives that they're just not from God. Do you believe that the devil and his demons, they want to distract you with relationships that will hinder your walk with Christ? You better believe it. There's some relationships in our lives that are just not from God, and we will nurture and we will try and grow those relationships, and maybe it benefits us with our hobbies or with our job or with whatever it is, and we'll try to grow those relationships. And then when we realize that we've left Jesus out of the equation and that we have to get back to Jesus and that relationship's in the way, it's just like, man, it gets harder and harder to get back to him because now you've got to get rid of that relationship to get back to Jesus. But it's things that we must do to keep him first. It shouldn't matter what we have to do to keep Jesus first in our lives. We see that one day's journey turned into 3 days. And we also see in verse 46, we also see that after 3 days, they found him in the temple. Where was Jesus this whole time? Right where they left him. Is it not the same with us that Jesus, he's always right where you leave him? He's not the one that left you. He's not the one that got out of fellowship with you. We're the ones that get out of fellowship with him. He's always right where we had left him. Right where you started dabbling in that little sin. Listen, I'm not up here trying to preach a holier-than-thou message. I know what the Bible says about who we are. Nobody's more spiritual than the next. I know that we go through the same things. We're all made of the same thing. We all go through the same things. Right where you started dabbling in that little sin. Sexual immorality took place in your life, whether it be things that you're looking at or whether it be things that when you go out and talk and try to get in a relationship with someone you ain't got no business being in a relationship with them, right where that sexual immorality started, right where that Holy Spirit conviction, where you rejected it and put it to the side, Lord, I'll handle that later. Where the conviction comes in, and I'm reading this, or I'm studying this, and trust me, I've already got the conviction every message that I do. I get it before y'all do. When I'm studying, I have to repent. Anytime that we read the Word of God, and if we're truly seeking of what God can get from me, not what can I, gimme, but what can I give to the Lord, there's going to be repentance made. There's going to be repentance made. When that Holy Spirit convicts you and you reject it and you grieve the Holy Spirit and you quench the Holy Spirit and you put them to the side, surely that's where you left Jesus. Today would be a good day to get back to the Lord Jesus. Today, I'm not here to preach fear into nobody. I'm not here to preach that and make people feel, look, the cure is Jesus Christ. We're all made of the same stuff. We all go through the same things. We all have the same nature, the fleshly nature. We all deal with these things in our lives. And I'm telling you that the cure for that is Jesus Christ. I know that some people's sin is different than other people's sin, and that Paul had a thorn in his side and a thorn in your side, and may be different than the thorn in my side. I'm not saying that we're all the same in that way, but you know what you're going through in your life. You know what needs to be repented of. And repentance is a daily thing. And you may be in here today, and you may have been in prayer, and you may have been seeking forgiveness and repentance where you should be, and that's what we're supposed to do. But we know that sin abounds. And where sin does abound, grace much more abounds. Jesus is the advocate of where sin comes up in our lives. Jesus can and will and is ready to forgive. I didn't come in here to make anybody feel bad about any decisions, but I came in here to preach to you the cure, the remedy, through Jesus Christ. It's time to get back to Him. Today will be a good day to come back to Him. He's right where you left Him, as we see in the Scriptures. Jesus was right where they left Him. And let's read in verses 47 through 49. We'll see that the Bible says, "And all that heard Him were astonished at His understanding and answers. And when they saw Him, they were amazed. And His mother said unto Him, Son, why hast Thou thus dealt with us? Behold, Thy father and I have sought Thee sorrowing. And He said unto them, How is it that you sought Me? Wish you not that I must be about My Father's business?" Jesus was right where they left Him because He was about His Father's business. He's right where we leave Him because He's about the Father's business. We tend to get sidetracked sometimes. And like I said, it's not that you are intentionally, on purpose, trying to hinder your relationship with Christ. But we've got to be honest with ourselves. If that relationship has got to improve, we've got to search our hearts. We've got to search the Scriptures. We don't compare ourselves to one another. We compare ourselves to the cross of Jesus Christ. We compare ourselves to the Scriptures. And you'll see that every time you do that, you fall short. And where you fall short, you take responsibility of that, and you admit it, and you confess it to the Father and seek for His forgiveness. And where there's forgiveness, there's also repentance. The goal is always restoration. It's always restoration. If there's going to be a revival, the goal is restoration. If there's going to be someone saved, the goal is restoration. Rededication to life, the goal is restoration. If you're going to come in here and be closer to Jesus when you leave today than when you came in today, it's going to be through restoration. Through the parts of our life that we need to give to the Lord. We see that Jesus was about His Father's business. Think of that. Think of that. His Father's business. We see that word business. Jesus said there's an exchange that needs to take place. There's a price that must be paid. I'm here on a business trip for my Father. I'm here because there's a payment that's got to be paid. Jesus at 12 years old was about that payment. In the temple that day, Jesus was about the payment and the sacrifice. You don't have to turn here, but in 1 Corinthians, if you can write it down if you're taking notes, 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 20. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 20. For ye are bought with a price. See, Jesus was about the Father's business. You were bought. You were purchased. Verse 20, you are bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. That's what Jesus was about. He was about the business. Today, we need to be about doing business with the Lord. To see that one drop of Jesus' blood does far more than thousands of gallons of animal blood could ever do. They were there in remembrance, and they were there in respect to the animal blood from the Old Testament to remove sin. But Jesus was there because He was about His Father's true business, which was had to do with His blood and that payment that it took for His blood to wash away our sinful nature. That's the business Jesus was about. The blood that saves, the blood that heals, and the blood that paid the price, the blood that cleanses your sinful nature as white as snow, that blood that purchased your soul. That blood that the 33-year-old Jesus hung on the cross and shed for us, that was by His stripes that we are healed. And it's that blood that He shed on the cross at 33 years old. As 12 years old, He had the same blood circulating through His body at 12 years old in the temple that day. And I believe that at 12 years old, Jesus was ready to pay the price if it was time. He was ready to pay that price at 12 years old. He said, "Don't you know I'm here because I'm about my Father's business?" Why are we here today? Why are we here this morning? They had some people who showed up because they were going with somebody else. Some people showed up just for the food. Some people showed up because they wanted to see and they wanted to be seen by others. And some people showed up because it was the churchy thing to do. There was customs and traditions. Some people showed up to play a part. I got something I've got to do at that church. I have to go. There's religious obligations there. I don't want to go, but I have to, because if I don't go, there's nobody else to do what I can do for God. They all had the same motive. They all had the same motive. And that was, what can I get from God? That was the benefits. They were there for the benefits, saying, if I go, maybe there's something there that I can get from God. Did you show up this morning wondering, is there something there that I can get from God? Can He enhance my situation? Can He enhance my life in any way? Is there any kind of benefit God has for me? I'll show up to the church and find out. Are you here this morning because of that? There's only one person with this motive at that feast, at that Passover. What can I give God? What is it that I can give to God. The crowd was looking at the benefits, and Jesus was looking at the sacrifice. Folks, we should be in here today wondering what we can give to God. Are there things in our life that we can sacrifice for God because we love Him? Not saying, hey, and don't get me wrong, there are benefits to the Christian life. Don't get me wrong. If you're going to pray for a job, or if you're going to pray for certain situations in your life, it's okay to go to Jesus for it. Who else are you going to go to? But when we show up in church, we don't need to come just for the benefits of God. We're here with the wrong motive. We need to come to church, and we need to be wondering, what is it in my life that I can sacrifice and that I can get rid of and that is a hindrance in my life? What can I give to God so that He can have more of me? Like I said, we already have all of Him. He's done everything He's needed to do for us on this side of glory. So what is it that we can do for Him? Surely we've all got stuff we can do for the Lord. And so before we leave here today, we all must answer that question. As we search our own hearts this morning, we all must answer the question, what's your motive for being here this morning? Is it just the churchy thing to do? Is it religious obligation? Is it to see and to be seen? Is it to because somebody else came, so you decided you have to go because somebody else is going? I've explained to you the Father's business. The Father's business is Jesus Christ on the cross at Calvary. Our faith started in Christ. We see in Colossians 1. Our faith started in Christ, and it must continue in Christ. Jesus is the author and the finisher of our faith. Here this morning, we must be about the Father's business. And if you're here for any other reason, if you came here for any other reason, and you don't do business with the Lord, and you don't repent and turn from that, and you don't seek that forgiveness, and you come in here for any other reason than the Father's business, you'll walk out of those doors without Jesus. You will walk out this morning without Jesus, just as they had done in the passage. They had walked out without Jesus. These altars are always open. We ain't gonna never close the altars. They're always open for anybody that wants to come in prayer. Maybe you showed up today hoping there's something to gain from God, but through the convicting power of the Holy Spirit, there's something you've been carrying around or dealing with, and you've got a heavy workload, and you got your schedule is so busy through each and every day, and you know that you need to clean it up, and maybe you don't know what needs to go, what needs to stay, if you need prayer on that, or maybe it's your life. Maybe you need to rededicate your life back to Jesus. Maybe you need to get saved this morning. Does everybody know the parable of the prodigal son? The prodigal son had left the father's house. But in that parable, the prodigal son, he left the father's house way before he left the father's house. Everything that we do, he was already gone in his mind. And it's the same way for us today. You don't got to be out of church to leave the father's house. Maybe you just need to get back in the right standing with the Lord. Brother, if you want to come up with a song. I know this message was a little short today. I've never preached before, but I hope with the convicting power of the Holy Spirit, we'll each take inventory of our lives. And I believe that God has a new season for this church. I believe He wants to move forward with this church. I don't believe He wants this church to get lazy and stay where it's at. But there's things that the believers must do in this church. There's areas of our lives that we must repent from, and that we must turn and focus more on the Lord. The church is just, He's not worried about the building. He's worried about the people. And I believe that as we come in here week after week and preach His Word, surely the purpose of that is saying, how can the Lord get more of me? Because as we give Him one area of our life, we start to slack in another area. It's just how we are. So as the song begins, I want us to look in our lives and see if there's any part in our lives where we have left the Lord behind. Any part where we have left Him. And if you'll go to, you'll see that He is right where we have left Him. Brother, you'll come with a song. Thank you.
Let's stand, please. Jesus is tenderly calling.
Jesus is tenderly calling me home, calling today.
Sometimes the Lord puts it on, may put it on your heart to sing a song, to come and sing a special. He might put it on your heart to answer the call to be a Sunday school teacher, or answer the call to preach, or whatever it may be. He wants to use people, absolutely. And maybe there's something that He's been tugging on your heart to answer and to do. And I just want to, if there's any, can we do another song, the invitation? If anybody knows that the Lord wants them to sing a song, to do a special, and they've been putting it off, if you know the Lord wants to use you in a way of teaching Sunday school, or maybe opening up a small Sunday school class, and that's how we grow as a church. And if there's anybody in here that you feel like maybe you've been called to preach, maybe you don't see yourself, maybe I ain't ready to preach, but I know that He's called me to preach. We need to start opening an invitation so that people can answer the call to God's purpose for them.
Mm-hmm. There is, and but Hardy had wanted to speak just a moment about a friend of his. We got this instrument here. We can give him to do that.
Okay. Yeah, and whenever you're done, you can close the service in prayer, and then we'll.
Well, I won't take up too much of y'all's time. I just wanted to come talk to you for a minute on behalf of my friend. His name is Jeffrey Holmes. We were roommates together at Mercer, and he's been battling cancer for over a year now. He found out last year on September the 15th that he has lymphoma, and he's been going through treatments and fighting it since then. And now he's got leukemia as well. I'm not sure when he found that out, but he's at the point now where he's gonna start clinical trials, but his insurance isn't gonna pay for those. His family just moved him to MD Anderson Cancer Center in Houston, and that's about 3.5 hours from his home in Arlington. So that being said, there's a lot of expenses that he and his family are having to deal with. So I'm asking if we can come together and take up a love offering for him and his family. Obviously he can't work to earn money right now, and his family are taking time out of their schedule to be with him and to give him support. So they'll appreciate anything that you can give, and it's okay if you can't give anything, but please pray for him and for God's presence and healing hand as he goes through these clinical trials. He's a good man and a God-fearing man, and I know he'll appreciate any prayers and support that you can send his way. And if there's anybody watching on video that wants to donate, just reach out to me or to anyone else here at the church, and we'll see that it gets to Jeffrey. Thank you. And now I'll close this with a word of prayer. Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for the opportunity to be in your house, to worship you. Lord, we thank you for all that you do for us. Please forgive us of our shortcomings. Help us to do more to serve you. And Lord, I ask that you be with Jeffrey today as he's fighting, and just please be with him, give him strength and comfort, help him to trust in you, and just please be with the doctors as they treat his cancer. We love you and we praise you. Thank you again for all you do for us. And we'll lift these things up to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Are we done? Let's stand, sing our family of God. Okay? Here we go.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I'm in Christ, it was mine. The land's mine, his blood. Joy theirs with Jesus as we travel this sun. For I'm part of the family, the family of God.
I think we're in competition, aren't we? You did good, man. You held it out there. Great.
Well, there's two of the church that can hold it out there, because I can't.
That's right. He wins me all the time. But he should. He's a great singer. He knows what's going on, and I'm still learning. So, all right, so we have, is this thing really loud, or is it just me? Okay. I'm going to back up a little bit. Okay. So we have a couple of things we do need to talk about business. I'm going to leave one of them for the very end. But one is that the Georgia Baptist Children's Home with the shoes. I think we need to be in prayer on that. But I know that Patricia's being kind of asked, because it'll sneak up on us pretty quick. They usually like to take the shoes down. When do they take them down?
First of December.
Okay, well, that's a little load off there, because I was thinking it was sometime the first weeks of November.
Yeah, we usually purchase the like the Black Friday sales, that's right. The good sales and everything.
I know Amber's been helping us in the past. Thank goodness for Amber, because before she was here, we were doing that. And you're talking about
a
wreck and a circus. That was a circus. You think losing Leland was a circus, man? You should have been there with us. But anyway, but that's something that's a good outreach to do. I know there's some other things. Phyllis was mentioning something to me in the back. I'm sorry I didn't get it all, because David was hounding me up from up here. You know, I could feel the spirits in the back of my head. And I was like, come on up here. We got to get started. I understand that. But we will talk about what you have more in depth. And then I'll bring it to the church. Will that be fine?
That's fine.
All right, Ms. Wiley, you had something. Was that right, or am I remembering wrong? Patricia, I need your help. Help me with who all was talking. Was there something else that we need to bring up today besides the one thing I've got solid in my mind? Okay, nothing else. Okay. We do need more choir members, man. Nobody's left. We gained one last week, and so if we can gain one this week, we'll be doing even better. So now it's my understanding, Trish and I have been talking to KM, and I believe that the pulpit committee has something that they'd like to say. I believe they have a recommendation. Is that correct?
Yeah. The pulpit committee, well, first of all, I'd like to appreciate thank the church for your patience and your prayers. And the pulpit committee would like to present Chase Carter as to be voted in as pastor of Western Baptist Church.
Okay. So they would like to nominate Chase Carter as our pastor for the church. So we need to take a vote. So should we do the nays first? All right, all in not in favor, please raise your hand. Golly, that's a lot of people. Just kidding, Chase. You know I can't be serious. That's why they're fixing to vote me out of this pool. All right, so all in favor of having Chase and voting Chase in as our pastor for our church and to help us lead this church and grow this church, please say amen and raise your hand at the same time, please.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I want to thank everybody. So, Chase, it looks like officially you and Jamie and Leland, and it's a small church, so you won't have much worry about losing Leland around here, because we can find him. We'd like to welcome you guys to our church, and we want to thank you so much for doing what you've done so far for our church. And we look forward to years of serving the Lord with you. Anything else that we'd like to bring up? If not, I would like to ask Brother KM if you would close us out, please.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the presence of the Holy Spirit here today. We thank you for your leadership, your guidance, and your direction. Father, we thank you for all that you do for us. And we pray that you will be with us, your shield of protection around each one of us. Help us to just be able to follow your will and guide your future. What you have to do in this community. These things we pray in Jesus' name.
Amen. I'm so glad. Oh, I'm sorry. We already done that.